Mariano Fortuny's full name was Mariano Fortuny y Madrazo, and although he was Spanish, he lived most of his life in Venice. He's known in many different worlds, in fashion and theater, in design, in textiles, and in fine art, but it's his interest in innovation that unifies all of the different things he did. He grew up in a family immersed in the arts with many interesting ancestors. His mother, Cecilia de Madrazo, came from a family of artists and hosted regular salons in their home where Marcel Proust was a regular. She was a pianist, she was an avid collector of antique textiles, and her father and grandfather were the first two directors of the Prado Museum. Fortuny's father, Mariano Fortuny y Marzal, was an important and accomplished Spanish artist known for his mastery of representing the effects of light, which is a skill and an interest that his son inherited. Fortuny y Marzal traveled extensively and returned with all manner of exotic wares, so Mariano Fortuny was born into an environment perfectly suited to inspire artistic innovation. This is a picture of his father's studio, which gives you a sense of the things he had around him as a child. Fortuny was only 3 when his father died, and his mother moved the family to Paris, and then 17 years later to Venice, to the Palazzo Martiniano, where her salons continued with a whole new crew of Venetian artists. The Italian aesthete and poet Gabriele D'Annunzio was one of her regulars. Because Fortuny remained in Venice, and his work is infused with a sort of Venetian sensibility, he's generally considered an Italian artist in spite of the rich Spanish history of his family. In 1898, Fortuny moved into the top floor of a 15th-century building and spent the rest of his life acquiring and restoring the rest of the building, which had been divided into many small apartments. The first chapter in Fortuny's professional life is relatively conventional. He started out as a painter. At the end of the 1890s, he started exhibiting his paintings, first in Munich and then in Venice and then in Paris. To investigate and celebrate his interest in Wagner's work, he painted a set of 46 Wagnerian mythologies, including this Flower Maidens from Parsifal. In 1899, he designed sets for a theatrical production in San Polo, which led to work on costumes and sets for a production of Wagner's Tristan and Isolde at La Scala in 1900. Working on this project helped Fortuny realize that theater lighting, available in 1900, didn't do much to advance Wagner's goal of a unified art in theater. At the time, lighting was either still candle footlights or very harsh electrical lighting that was hard to control and didn't do much to add atmosphere. Fortuny began experimenting to create adjustable lighting effects that could change to match the changing moods and locations presented on stage. He discovered that reflected light is more controllable than direct light, and developed a system which he patented in 1901. Arc lighting had been used since the 1870s, but it's a very harsh form of light, and by reflecting arc light off of surfaces that were coated with a emery powder, Fortuny was able to produce an even and kinder sort of indirect light. His 1904 treatise, Éclairage scénique, or stage lighting, describes the discovery that formed the basis of his indirect lighting technique. And he wrote, "It is not the quantity, but the quality of light that makes things visible and allows the pupil to open properly." In 1902, he arrived at a radical proposal for a stage intervention, which would allow these lighting advances to be rescaled and change how electricity illuminated stage scenery. This is a model in his Paris studio of the Fortuny Dome. The full name is the Fortuny Cyclorama Dome, and it's a hugely scaled-up light reflector. It allowed lighting effects and also the illusion of greater space than would actually have fit on a stage. The patent is from 1906, but it's something that he developed in 1902. It's kind of a crazy idea, and yet it worked in a brilliant and novel way. The patent language describes it this way. A concave background is formed by exhausting the airspace between two sheets of fabric, the inner of which is attached at its edges to a curved framework, the outer being attached to a framework. Air is exhausted by a fan. So a fan was used to move air into and out of the space between two layers of fabric, which were attached to the framework of the dome. And that allowed it to collapse in 90 seconds. So very fast stage transformation. And the largest that he installed was at La Scala in Milan in 1922. So that's a 20-year gestation period to perfect the technology. And the patent drawing shows not only the fabric and the layers between, but also the fan mechanism. As Fortuny began adapting the dome to use in different theaters, he arrived at a variety of scales and mechanisms. On the right are some models he made, and on the left it shows a cutaway of a theater with the dome installed in the pre-existing space. So he was also trying to work with what theaters had, but create a more modern stage effect. Once Fortuny figured out even reflected light and huge fabric dome surfaces, he continued to develop new mechanical proposals to affect the quality and the quantity of light for stage production. This drawing shows the next phase, which is bouncing light off of an advancing strip of colored fabric to change the lighting hue and the feeling of the reflected light. So as the roller moves and the color on the fabric changes, the light being bounced off of that would also change and be transferred to the whole surface of the dome. Fortuny made this functioning electric demonstration model to show the dramatic changes achievable with the dome and the lighting system. So with just one set, endless moods and atmospheres could be achieved through lighting. That's a more effective way to think about mounting a complicated staging or a complicated piece of theater, which would have involved lots of sets. In this program, you just have one set or two sets and lots of lighting effects. Fortuny filed many patents and produced an entire album full of theater drawings with different ideas to further his investigations into stage sets and lighting. He had lots of patents, and interestingly, he filed patents globally. There are patents filed in Italy, in France, in England, and in America for his different innovations. The success of the theater dome and the innovative stage lighting led the German electric company, AEG, to produce and sell Fortuny's stage lighting system. And for industrial designers, this is a fascinating little moment because it connects Fortuny, who's usually not thought of as an industrial designer, to Peter Behrens, who's considered one of the greatest early industrial designers. So that's a story for another time, but the link between innovation in Italy in 1900 and innovation in Germany in 1900 and the use of electricity is a really interesting and lively one. So the lighting system became commercially available as a product, as a lighting system, and as a result, installed in theaters throughout Europe. All theaters were struggling with the same problems that new electric lighting couldn't really be harnessed in a way that made better stage scenery. And Fortuny figured that out, and the AEG sort of packaged it and sold it. Fortuny also developed a number of lamps using his early innovation of achieving even reflected light. Remember that in 1907, it's still very early to be producing electric light fixtures, and there was no real system for or consensus on what electric devices should look like. But I would say by any standards, this Fortuny floor lamp is a radical and modern-looking object for 1907. The light it produced was so superior to other lamps that it existed beyond the concerns of aesthetics. This floor lamp works the same way as the Fortuny dome in that it uses reflected light. There's a bright light source shining instead of out at the room, it's shining into the dome. It's shining into a parabolic reflector and sent out in a more even reflected way. Today, this looks like a designed lamp to us, but in 1907, to have no applied decoration on an object intended for domestic use was pretty radical. Fortuny also developed versions of this lamp. There was a ceiling lamp. This is the table lamp. If someone asked me to date this lamp just looking at the forms, I would have to say it's Art Deco. It's got smooth, undecorated, concentric forms that look machine-made. And in fact, it predates that. It's 1907. Fortuny lamps are still made today. And for me, that's a real sign of successful innovation, that 100 years later, a design could still be compelling. The construction details are different now, but the overall form and the way the lamp works are all the same. We also need to know that Fortuny was interested in photography at a time when photography was still a very complicated undertaking, and an enthusiast would have to be part artist and part chemist to prepare all of the chemicals and surfaces needed. Throughout his career, he used photography to record the world around him and to sort of sketch for artistic purposes. On the left is a self-portrait from 1890, and on the right, a portrait of Henriette Nigrin from 1905. She was his muse from 1897 on. He met her in Paris. And she was his business partner from around 1904 on, and his wife from 1918 on. As a side note, she's sort of central to the story. She inspired Fortuny throughout his career, but she also worked alongside him, participating in all of the later fabric and clothing production. She had been working as an artist model for student painters in Paris when they met in 1897, and she moved to Venice in 1902, although they didn't marry for years because his family didn't really approve of the union. He photographed and painted her many, many times throughout their long relationship, and it's pretty rare and remarkable to see such intimate and beautifully painted portraits throughout someone's entire life. You watch her age as you look at the portraits. In addition to photography, etching challenged Fortuny's interest in technical art forms. He was fascinated by the complexities of producing images on metal using different techniques. The Fortuny story gets really interesting when he starts to combine all of his interests together. So his ability to produce even bright electric light could, he realized, allow him to take techniques that he knew from photography and techniques that he knew from printing and apply them to fabric. He would soak silks in a gelatin, on top of which he would outline a design with a chemical solution, either manually or photographically, and exposing that gelatin to light hardens the chemicals to work as a resist that can then be washed off after printing and dyeing. So it's resist printing, but using modern technologies. And as a result, panels of fabric became canvases for Fortuny's complex and evocative patterns. Fortuny's early textile investigations led him to produce his earliest apparel, the Knossos scarves, which were large, lightweight scarves with rich patterns. In 1912, Vogue published an article called The Robes of Fortuny, written by Marguerite O'Kane, and she wrote, "Mr. Fortuny is not a couturier. He is primarily, in the dressmaking world, a creator of fabrics. He takes a piece of unfurred cloth, chiffon, lawn, crepe, what you will, and paints or stencils upon it a design of such rare beauty that it would be a sacrilege to consider further decoration." Fortuny also developed hardware that would allow the Knossos scarf to be joined at the shoulder and worn as a sort of overgarment. The Vogue article continued, "The materials used are of a curious Eastern texture, which is woven to the order of the artist. These extraordinary stuffs, inwrought with gold that appears dim with age, and deft patterns in strange tones of grays, browns, blues, and greens, seem indeed relics of primitive magnificence." And if you remember the picture of his father's studio, that makes a perfect sort of sense. Here are pictures of some different ways the scarves could be worn using some of the hardware that he developed. Fortuny continued his textile investigations by experimenting with how his techniques could transform velvet. Using processes that can be aided by bright, even light to transfer patterns onto velvet, he arrived at very complicated burnout or devoiré patterns. And they perfectly suit his interest in complex, exotic patterns, in fabric printing, and engraving and lighting technology. He got all of those to come together to make these remarkable velvets. And once able to produce large squares of patterned fabric, he had to start figuring out what they could become. And he started by turning the panels into clothing. They were simple silhouettes that celebrated the textiles more than they did any particular style of fashion. But they all succeed with a sort of nod to ancient clothing types. And he continued to explore different applications for his amazing fabrics, producing a variety of beautiful evening dresses and house coats and robes. But he pretty quickly realized that robes and tunics and jackets that are this unique present a real problem. You can't wear them with anything else. You can't just put them on over some other dress you have. And Fortuny realized that they were crying out for an undergarment that was neutral enough to allow the textiles to be the primary focus, but would also further the aesthetic, a sort of pedestal for his creations. In 1907, Fortuny introduced his Delphos gown. It's a simple column of pleated silk, which is at the same time a rich celebration of texture and color, but also a neutral layer to complement his patterned Knossos scarves, his jackets, his coats, and his tunics. He filed a patent, which was granted in 1909, for a machine to pleat fabric, although the actual process still remains a secret, which amazes me. It is probably finger-pleated when wet and then set with heat. We only know what the device looks like, not how it's used. And each panel of fabric winds up containing about 450 pleats, so it's no small undertaking. The pleats can be maintained by storing the dress in a tightly wound ball in a custom-made box. Alone, or in tandem with other Fortuny textiles, the Delphos dress created a real sensation. Marcel Proust, who had been a regular at the salon Fortuny's mother hosted in Paris, wrote in La Prisonnière in 1923, "The Fortuny dress Albertine wore that night seemed like the tantalizing shadow of invisible Venice. It was covered in Arab ornamentation, just like Venice, just like Venetian palaces disguised as sultans behind a veil pierced with stones, just like the binding in the Ambrosian Library. Just like the columns with oriental birds that alternately mean life and death and are repeated in the mirage of the clothes, in a deep blue that, as my eyes approached it, became changeable, thanks to the same transmutations that, in front of the advancing gondola, became metal inflaming the azure of the Grand Canal. And the sleeves were lined in a cherry pink that is so Venetian it is especially called Tiepolo pink." At the time, in 1907, everything that defined what a woman was and what a woman could be was in flux. In 1893, it was New Zealand that first granted suffrage to women, giving women the vote, and that was a struggle which triumphed around the world shortly after that. Female doctors won the right to practice at the time, and women were starting to have very public successes in fields that had been closed to them before. The redefining of women found a welcome redefining of the female silhouette in Fortuny's Delphos dress. With its form-clinging pleats and flowing loose lines, it's a celebration of the woman's form and of liberation. There's emphasis of a woman's figure instead of constriction. This is a picture of Selma Schubert, who was Alfred Stieglitz's sister, in a rare early color photograph by Stieglitz. And she's wearing a Delphos dress in 1907, and everything about her, her silhouette, her attitude, even that it's a color picture in 1907, is a completely different forward-looking idea about what a woman should be. In 1907, a tea dress, which is a dress intended to be worn in the afternoon while entertaining, was not a casual affair. The corseted, constrained rigidity of the Edwardian woman was very formal. And the dress used a vast quantity of fabric and structure. A Fortuny dress, on the other hand, was a single layer of fabric, without foundation garments, and with a freedom of movement that must have been electrifying, if not bordering on obscene. Even tea dresses by famous designers from the day can't compare to Fortuny's level of innovation. They're beautiful garments, but they're modern versions of old-fashioned types of clothing. These are Fortuny's patents from 1912 and 1914, where he patented the actual construction of some of his garments. And to me, they seem like almost an abuse of the patent system, because it's just, how do I attach two panels of fabric? However, even though Fortuny was referencing ancient classical robes, this approach to dressmaking was remarkably novel for its day. It's the very simplicity of construction that made the garments worthy of a patent. The dress didn't come from nowhere. On one hand, it's a material study. Fortuny looked at what he could do with the tools he had available and arrived at that method of pleating. On the other hand, it's a response to a need. He needed to make a pedestal for his other garments, but there are also plenty of classical references that he was knowingly making. The dress is clearly inspired by the classical Greek chiton, the robe, and it was named after the charioteer of Delphi, which had been discovered in 1896. So it's a very knowing reference to this form of clothing. And there are even older precedents, not just for the loose silhouette of the dress, but also for the pleating. Both of these sculptures are at the Louvre and were when Fortuny lived in Paris, and he certainly would have been familiar with them. In addition to classical references, Fortuny was influenced by Moroccan caftans and old Tunisian garments, many of which he collected and his father had collected. Fortuny developed an extended family of variations on the original Delphos dress, and found great success. Over 100 workers bustled away in the top floor of the Palazzo's workrooms, and Fortuny opened boutiques in Paris and in London. He showed his fabrics in 1914 in New York, although World War I prevented overseas distribution. and that had to be picked up after the war. Gabrielle D'Annunzio wrote after seeing Henriette Fortuny wearing an early version of the dress in 1910, she was enveloped in one of those long oriental gauze scarves that the alchemist dyer Mariano Fortuny submerges in the mysterious potions of his cauldrons, stirring them with a wooden stick, first like a sylph, then like a gnome, where he obtains colors from strange dreams and later prints them with his thousands of new generations of stars, plants, and animals. Many of the great artists of the day embraced the Delphos dress, making it a real symbol of modernity. On the left is Isadora Duncan with her daughter and her poet husband, and on the right, a Georges Barbier drawing of her dancing in a Delphos dress. This is Lillian Gish, one of America's greatest silent screen actresses at the peak of her career. And on the right, a very colorful woman, Natasha Rombova, who was Rudolph Valentino's wife and a Hollywood costume and set designer. This is French music hall star Régine Fleury and Lady Bonham Carter, who was daughter of Asquith, the British Prime Minister. She was, in her own right, a politician, an orator, a very close friend of Winston Churchill's, and grandmother of Helena Bonham Carter. So for anyone out there in the Harry Potter generation, here's a direct link from Mariano Fortuny to Bellatrix Lestrange. From 1920 on, Fortuny produced yardage of many of his patterns for use in interiors, and it's a remarkable collection and range of types of techniques of working with fabric and resultant images. It's important to note that he didn't always design the patterns. Fortuny's interest was primarily in finding modern ways to simulate ancient textiles and recreating and interpreting important textile designs, mostly seen in paintings. He was a great collector of textile patterns from fine art paintings. This is Eleanor of Toledo and her son Giovanni by Bronzino, and on the right, the Fortuny fabric inspired by her dress. I think the Fortuny story gets even better because as he develops, he looks for ways to fold all of his interests together. And for me, that's the sign of a great innovator. Each problem that gets solved isn't put away. The solution is kept active and becomes part of all future solutions, so that the problem solving is sort of cyclical more than it is linear. Fortuny combined his passion for pattern and fabric and his ability to produce remarkably elegant and complicated patterns on silk with his understanding of electric light and how to manipulate it. Among the early commercially available electric lamps, long before we figured out what electric light fixtures could be with any sort of design authority, Fortuny was producing these remarkable silk pendant electric lamps. These lamps continue to be made today by Venetia Studium. And that's rare for a career to venture through so much and so many varied territories. But how rarer still to find a way to circle around and give the variety of those interests and successes a combined and unified expression. It would be easy to forget that Fortuny considered himself primarily a painter, and I think that's kind of hilarious to have had such radical, widespread success in so many fields, but still define yourself as a fine artist. He painted throughout his career, and his style developed throughout as well, along with his experience and the changing times. The central interest in his paintings were landscapes and the female form and luxurious fabrics. They all are infused with a sensuality and an exotic flavor, and that's true from the beginning all the way through the end of his paintings. Fortuny died in 1949. Operations at the factory on the island of Giudecca were taken over by Elsie McNeil Lee, who had been distributing his work in New York City since 1928. In 1994, the Reard family took over the operations, and today they continue to produce Fortuny's fabrics. Henriette donated the palazzo and its contents to the city of Venice in 1956, and she lived until 1965. Today, the palazzo is a museum and well worth a visit. So that's a little Mariano Fortuny 101. He's one of my favorite figures in design history, oftentimes left out of conversations about the history of design because no one knows quite where to put him, and my argument would be put him everywhere.